So returning from lunch, I hope everybody is still incarnate in your flesh. Well, in this portion of our presentation, I reserved to read and reflect a little better over the great text that is the base of the theme of this seminar. So, in a Gospel according to the Spirit, Spiritism, that explains about the moral person. So, prior to Kardec, to enlist a list of virtues, of attributes of the moral person, he writes a small introduction. He says, the true good person is he who fulfills the law of righteousness, love, and charity in his deepest purity. Recollecting here that he refers to the third part of the Spiritist book, the moral laws, especially the last moral law, which is the law of justice, love, and charity. One single law. If he interrogates his conscience over his own actions, if they have violated this law, if they have done any evil, if they have done all the good they could, if they had willingly disregarded any opportunity to be useful, if anyone might have a complaint about them, and finally, if they have done unto others everything they would like to have done unto themselves. There are some details here that I'd like to comment. The first thing is that when Kardec establishes in the Spiritist book the last moral law is one single law, the law of justice, love, and charity, that we used to separate law of justice and law of love. There is no division. It's a single law, justice and love, because one is not just, is not righteous if there is no love. And love in its plenitude contains justice. The unjust love is an imperfect love. And justice without love is not justice. It's a very important point. So we can, we need this. We need to keep a balance between what is the rule, the righteous, and what is love. The true love encompasses the justice. The justice is within it. It's a point that sometimes gives us some hard time. Because when righteousness detaches itself from love, it becomes revenge. So it's not just, is the justicer. And what's the problem about the justicer? By exceeding, going over the justice, it goes out of the role of someone who applies the justice to become a criminal. Because there's now a difference between who broke the law and who to enforce the law exceeded the power. So there's a difference. there's a subtle point that we need to reflect upon. Another question is, God's love, it's not detached from the supreme justice. That is to say, each one receives according to his works. Each one takes the consequences of their choices and the actions. There's no privilege. No one, there's no immunity. There's no exception for this rule in the universe. The supreme justice presides all the hearts, all the destinies, all the fates, without exception. However, we can't imagine him as well, the creator as a penitentiary director. And sometimes we get into this kind of reasoning when we consider payment, debt, chargeback, non-negotiable, a creator that doesn't have the resource to help us in a fulfillment of our spiritual fate. I remember one case, a story. Chico Xavier used in his hometown in the state of Minas Gerais every weekend. They used to go out and visit a very poor area of the city, and then there they used to read the gospel according to the Spiritism, give away some food, doing some charity, material and spiritual. And one time he was going there, and a lady approached him in tears, in desperation. She said, "Chico, for God's sake, help me, my son is dying." The child was sick, and then Chico embraced her and said, "Daughter, let's pray." The mother's prayer knocks down the heaven's door. So we can't imagine God as a computer system. God is God, with sensibility, sensitivity, feeling, infinite love, decision. God is like a being that interacts, that relates to. In order, this way, Emmanuel writes, God can transform, redo, rebuild everything at any moment. Everything can be rebuilt, redone. New deliberations may occur. It's a very important point. Another thing that's brought to our attention about the moral person is that we realize immediately that the theme here is moral. And moral, it's about conduct. It's how do you live, how you proceed. And yesterday we were talking about with the center's workers, and we just recollecting what we spoke last night. What would be of the old jokes if we're not the newborns? So I hope some here didn't hear my jokes yet, didn't hear as a new, as something new. So Francis of Assisi used to say, preach the gospel, and if necessary, with words.
That
we may update, teach the Spiritism, if necessary, use the words. Because the project here, it's a lifestyle project. As a Calbart, a German theologist, a Protestant, he said, Christianity is a lifestyle.
And
when we read the gospel, we see that Jesus didn't bring new theories. You don't see him talking to somebody about God's nature. There's not a point in the gospel that Jesus is talking about God's nature. There's nothing like this in the gospel. And I ask, is there anyone with more resources to do it than Jesus? So he was the one with conditions to do this, and he didn't do it. But there is a speech of his that it's a little embarrassing, but reflects the reality. And there's everything to do with what we are studying here now. In the Sermon of the Mount, he says about good, shine your light before men so they can see your good works and glorify God. I thought it was to glorify me. So I was expecting applause for that. May your light shine. But why? Because he ends saying, be perfect as our Father is perfect. It's a very interesting point. We're going to talk about the first virtue of the moral person. What Jesus meant is, God is so transcendent. God is so absolute. That we can't learn as a whole. There's no way. It would be like you try to put the ocean into a cup. It doesn't fit. Simply doesn't fit. But we can have a very relevant experience about God, and one of them, a very important one, it's when you experience God in your neighbor. So Philip asks to Jesus about God. Show us God. And Jesus answered calmly, Philip, you're looking at me and not seeing. It's a difficult to understand text. But what Jesus means is, I'm here channeling God at every moment, and you can't see it. Furthermore, in Apostles' Acts, we're going to see a report that God operated wonders through whose? Timothy's hand. This is so subtle. Because if you are going through a difficult moment, depressed and crying, and then God materializes himself and says, I am God, takes out of a tissue, dry out your tear. Is that how it works? No. He works through someone else that unexpectedly crosses your way. So you live in your life in an immense difficult moment, and somebody shows up and gives you a book, a message, and helps you. Somebody showed up. It's not exactly like this.
O Criador,
the Creator,
tutela os seus filhos,
tutors his children through his children.
Então começa a agir and then pelas mãos daqueles.
He acts through the hands of those who understood these dynamics and put themselves at the disposition. This is the moral person. This is the good person. What we mean is, what we are saying here is very subtle. Very subtle. We are saying the following. None of us, imperfect beings, creatures, limited creatures, may request the gift of being capable of loving the entire humankind. You know why? Because we don't have reserve of love enough for this. However, God has it. God has the reserves. The moral person is someone who is in connection, in communion with God. Who is in communion with God is connected to a reservoir, an infinite reservoir. It never ends. So God, the person, the moral person consoles because it's consoled, loves because it's loved. It gives because it manages already to be grateful to the one who receives. It's a relation. It's a fundamental point of this text. It's a relationship between the parts. So the way we relate to God reflects profoundly on all of the other relationships that we have. Every single relationship. Because this relationship with God is the fundamental relationship. It is the basic relationship. And becomes with the first virtue of the moral person.
Deposita fé em Deus. Na sua bondade,
it had faith in God, in his goodness, in God's goodness, justice, and wisdom. Faith in God, in goodness, his goodness, justice, and his wisdom. Who's the most with goodness? Who is the most wisdom and the most of justice? God. I'm going to ask a difficult question. Between you and God, who is the most intelligent? We have a doubt. Let me think about it.
Deus.
God. That's why we don't understand sometimes certain things that he does. We can only understand afterwards, later. Have faith in God's goodness, justice. They know that nothing happens without his permission. So they submit to the divine will in everything. Why is this? This is the first virtue, faith. But I'd like to open a parenthesis. We realize that the text is based on virtue. So the first one is faith. For some of them, he's going to spend it to 1, 2, 3 paragraphs. But about, we're going to first talk about the faith in God and then other types of fear. Faith. But we have a problem with faith, which is a problem of understanding, of terminology and understanding of the idea. We are educated over 2,000 years or more. It's a religious education. So the planet was educated, so it was formed, so led to think of a faith. When you hear faith, the first thing that comes in your mind is belief. To believe or not to believe. But this is the beginning, the very beginning of faith. The faith is way much more than this. Much, much, much more. You can take the origin of the word in Latin, in Greek, and in Hebrew, where the biblical texts appear, and then Latin that gave has origin for most of languages is a numerous family of languages, including English. Faith. Let's start from Latin. That's easier. Fides. From this root comes the word fidelity, fidelity. So in the essence of the word faith is fidelity. Thus, we can't think about fidelity without thinking of relationship. So when I say faith, I'm not talking about believing. To believe is presupposed, isn't it? So to make it easier, do you believe that your wife or your woman exists? Some don't. Do you believe that your husband exists? No? Yes? I do believe. But do you believe that God exists? Maybe. Yes, I do. But the virtue, faith, has to do with fidelity, and you are only loyal when you relate yourself to. Because fidelity presupposes a relationship. I can only be loyal to God and God be loyal to me if we relate to one another. Do you think marriage is difficult? You should see the relationship with God, because God is always the other one. Levinar is a great Jewish philosopher. He wrote a book talking about this matter. Relate to God. God is the other one in our relationship. And we have difficulty in the relationship because we have difficulty with the other one. Because even in our infancy experience, when we still live psychologically like a child, the child sees the other as an extension of oneself. It's a mutual experience. Mother is an extension of myself. That's why to be born is sad. Because it breaks the symbiotic bond, and you are forced to recognize that you are the other one. Initially, you don't see your mother, you identify her by the smell. And it starts a process of recognition of the other one, which is difficult. A lot of people go through life without relating to people because it has difficulty to understand that the other one is not an extension of oneself. But how is it possible not to like what I like? It's an absurd, we think. I can't understand a person that has a different opinion of me is inadmissible. And this is about a relationship. Now we are talking about equal beings. What about the relationship with God? He's absolute. You are relative. See how it gets difficult, the relationship now, for us, not for him. It's difficult. It's hard. It's beautiful. It's something that we have to think about. The difficulty in relate to God is that you think that you can predict what he's going to do, but you can't. There's no way to anticipate the actions of God. And God is a being, is the one who decides in one detail. Of every God's purpose, it becomes true. God doesn't manifest purpose at random, because everything that he wants, it comes true. That's why he doesn't want many things, but just few things. God is selective in his wanting. Otherwise, the universe would be a disaster. Look at how difficult it is.
Get the challenge. Actually, this is the theme of temptations. Because evidently, the passage of Matthew from the temptation of Christ is obviously a parable. Scripture and the way that was narrated is just a figure. It's the way it was narrated. There is a fact behind it, but it wasn't exactly how it took place. The way it was narrated, it's a very well done parable because it summarizes the passage of the Hebrew people through the desert. The Hebrew people went through those six temptations but fell in three. What does that have to do with temptations? In the temptations, what is the trial? What is the test? What is the test? A test is the relationship with God. Let's go to the second one. The devil, which wears Prada, talks to Jesus this way. Throw yourself. Jump. Because it says the hands of the angels will sustain you. In other words, look, it's guaranteed. Aren't you the Christ? It's guaranteed. Jump. You're not going to fall. You can do it. Go take the risk. It's guaranteed. Aren't you the Christ? And Jesus says, it's also written, don't tempt your Lord your God. You don't have control over God. You don't control God. You can't predict. It's not like that. He doesn't work for you. He doesn't also work for your spiritist center. Maybe he doesn't even root for your team. He is the other. So faith is the supreme challenge of human beings. Faith is the supreme challenge for humans. Why? The supreme human challenge. Because there comes a time when the test comes. The TOEFL of faith, which is the surrendering. Are you able to surrender yourself? And then this other. Are you able to surrender yourself completely to this other? Are you going to surrender the steering wheel or not? That's the test. That's why Kardec begins to say, deposit faith. They have faith in God, or deposit faith in God. The moral person deposit takes all of it, the trust that they have, all the trust, and they deposit it. Account number, God. Knowing that nothing happens without God's permission, in other words, they surrender. So then there's no faith. I don't have faith. Well, yes. That's the challenge of faith. To believe or not believe, that's the beginning stages. To believe or not believe is like milk for the infant. The test, the challenge of this virtue is not that. So I'm going to read the text. Oh, a text from the spirit author Meimei, found in the book Letters from the Heart. The message is called Trust Always. Because it's beautiful to see trust. Trust is to weave with. In the company of. So I put the line across and I weave. Now your turn. Your turn. No, I'm not going to do it. Okay, fine, Father, I'll do it again. Your turn. Now I'm going to weave twice. Because he's the other. Oh, I don't control him. That's why I also love to repeat many times. It's so incredible. They came to Mother Teresa and said, Mother Teresa, when you are praying, what do you say to God? She says, I don't say anything. I just listen. Oh, wow. Huh. Okay. So you only listen, huh? So what does God say to you? And she says, he doesn't say anything. He just listens. But that's brilliant. This spirit of Mother Teresa reached a level of faith. Faith has nothing to do with belief. Faith has to do with relationship. She just said, I listen to him. Well, what does he say? And he's in silence. And to date somebody in a relationship. Do you have to say anything? Not really. Sometimes to say actually gets in the way to say something. So faith is to relate yourself with God, to have a relationship with God. So the spirit author Emmanuel, look at how things are connected. He says the following: God manifests himself through the circumstances and the people that cross our destiny. So I enter into relationship with God. Look, he looks up. Why do we have to look up? Maybe he's down. To relate with God, let me look down. He's everywhere. Why do I have to look up? Just look up. Right? Okay, I'm going to start with relationship with God. All right, I'll start looking. I'm waiting for him to talk. What is he going to say? You're looking the wrong way. Because I manifest myself in the circumstances of your life, in the situations. So pay attention what is going to happen in your life. And even better, be alert as to the things that don't happen to you in your life. I heard a very beautiful sentence. Pay a lot of attention in what I am not saying. Because sometimes we can't listen and we make assumptions. So pay attention in the things that I am not saying, please. So what doesn't happen, or what is interrupted, or perhaps what is not permitted, is also a manifestation of God. So look how beautiful this message by the Spirit Mei. I'm just going to contextualize for you, because this is important. The Spirit Mei is a wonderful lady, young. She was 22 years old. She got married with Arnaldo Rocha. And that love story is beautiful. 1 year later, she died. Arnaldo lost more than 10 pounds. It was a huge shock for him. It was frightening. He was very materialist, atheist. And then, so he's walking in the street in a rush. Somebody, he hits a person in the middle of the street. The person falls on the floor with the briefcase and all those papers flying around. He's trying to collect everything. He looks at him. Who is it? It's Chico Xavier. The interesting thing here is that her name is not Mei Mei. her name is Irma de Castro. May was her nickname, her romantic pen name, because they saw those Chinese Oriental movies. And so there was the beautiful woman from the movie, her name was May. And so that was what he called her, my May. When he looked at Chico, he said, I'm sorry. Aren't you Chico Xavier, the guy from the TV interview? She takes him by the hand and calls him by his nickname, Arnaldino. Our little May, our dear May, is here telling us that today is your wedding anniversary. And for you to please accompany me to the meeting. And he said, I'll go wherever you want me to go. He went to the mediumistic meeting, and there Chico channels the spirit of May through the voice, and the spirit talked to Arnaldo. So this is the story. I'm going to read the message. Now I'm going to read one of the messages she channels, just so you can understand who this spirit is, because what she's going to say in the message is life. It's about her personal life. It's not just a message. She says, don't lose your faith amidst the shadows of the world, even if your feet are bleeding. March ahead, lifting your faith through divine light above yourself. Believe and work, making efforts in the good, and wait with patience. Everything shall pass, and everything renews itself on earth, but what comes from heaven remains here. Everything passes, everything renovates itself on earth, but what comes from heaven shall remain. Of all the unfortunate people, the most unfortunate ones are the ones who have lost their trust in God and in themselves. Because the hardest, the biggest unfortunate is to suffer the privation of faith and to continue living without that faith. Therefore, elevate your gaze and walk, fight and serve, learn and develop yourself. The light shines beyond the night. Today, it is possible that the storm may shrink your heart and trouble your ideals, pressing you with affliction or with death. But don't forget that tomorrow is another day. Tomorrow is another day. This is faith. The person of the moral person is in this vibe. They vibrate in this frequency. It's in this vibe, which is the vibe of trust. If it's in the storm, it's because the light is going afterwards. Is in the night, it's because there will be dawn. In difficulty, because later abundance will come. The help always comes, but it's not instant. But it's about trust. So trust. And so guess, that's the first virtue. Trust. So we've been able to realize so far, up to this point, and we need to say this, many times we face spiritual programs like it's a banking system. So I go to the bank. Oh, hello, teller. I wanted to renegotiate my loan. Well, but that's not possible. I wanted to... the system doesn't allow it. Sorry, the system doesn't permit. So we imagine that spiritual programs are like that. Yeah, we have a spiritual programming. I was going to reincarnate on the 20th of September in 1971, and my mother was going to have 7 centimeters of dilation at 9 o'clock. At 9:30, I was being born. So it's all programmed. So 9 o'clock came, what happened with my dilation? Well, that's not how it works in the programming, the spiritual programming. I remember there was a very funny gentleman, older gentleman in my hometown, his Leon Zalio, and one person was telling him, well, the next incarnation we're going to come and we're going to do this work and that, and he said, what if I don't want to? What if I don't want to? You understand? So the programming comes. All right, we're going to do this and this and then the plan. Let's follow it like this. So I arrive here and we say, okay, I don't want it anymore. So, do you understand? So reincarnation is dynamic. Is a vivid, living game. Is dynamic. But the moral person is stable. So much so that, look at something here, how curious. In this chapter, Be Perfect in the Gospel According to Spiritism. I'm going to read the title of the items of this chapter. This is a good exercise for us to do. Kardec had hundreds of messages that were spiritual messages. And then he read, he gave titles to the chapters, and he thought of that. He just didn't throw everything up in the air. He thought about the titles. When he thought about the titles, how did he choose the messages? What are the messages that are contained in the chapter Be Perfect? You know what they are? Look, duty, that's one of them. Duty. Virtue. The superior and the inferior. The individual and the world, to take care of the body and the spirit. Why is in this chapter called Be Perfect? You can't think of a moral person without thinking of a person that fulfills his duty. Who has fidelity to God and also fidelity to the commitments he forged. These things are inseparable. But let's not be naive. You can guarantee that you will be loyal, but you cannot guarantee that the other person will be faithful. That's why he deposits first faith in God and knows that without God's permission, it wouldn't happen. So trust in God. Second, have faith in the future, the reason for which it puts the spiritual goods above temporary material goods. So, faith in the future. This is very beautiful because the gift or the present is heir. The present is the heir of our past. So, in other words, sometimes there's really nothing we can do. In certain situations that you go through that are the end result of a process which had its beginning a long time ago. It's like the climax or the conclusion. So there's nothing you can do at that point. Now it's about dealing with the consequences. But the future is the heir of the present. And most importantly, the future belongs to God. In the future, God acts with all his possibilities. So have faith in the future. Which is the message we read. Trust always. Tomorrow will be another day. It's about perspective. It's about knowing how to deal with it. There are some things that cannot be changed. Because you no longer are in the phase of choices. You are in the phase of its consequences. The choices were made. The path was already treaded. You're the end of a process. So now we need to accept. And there are things that are still being planned out. So think clearly. If you look for an economic consultant, we need to plan your retirement. Don't do this investment here, especially here in this country, this investment here, these funds. So we can say, today we are here, all of us gathered, doing some consulting with the Gospel According to Spiritism so that we can plan our future reincarnations. So that they can be more light and pleasant. So they can be more adequate. It's a planning process. So while we discern, we can do things and change behaviors and relating, having relationships in a different way. So he knows that all of the trials of life and all the sorrows and all of the resentments are trials or expiations that you accept without changing. If we go to the chapter, the blessed are the meek and the peace-loving. There's a message called obedience and resignation. In this item, the Spirit says, obedience is the allowing of reason. Resignation is the allowing of the heart. In other words, there isn't faith where there isn't obedience and resignation. Because there are certain moments in our life where you say, it's going to be my way or the highway, and life says no. And then what happens? You obey, your reason gives in, but your heart doesn't, and so you become a bitter creature with resentments, depressed. Pessimistic. Because your reason obeys. There was no other option. But your heart was not in it. It didn't give. And resignation is when your heart gives in and accepts, surrenders. It'll be for the best. So obedience and resignation are part of this faith. That's why he concludes this item about faith. Because the next paragraph, he talks about another virtue. We leave this virtue about faith, trust in God, faith in the future, and now the theme of pains, of sorrows, of difficulties that we encounter. And here, there is a point, an item that calls our attention. The biggest motive for people to lose their trust in God happens for when they lived through experiences of pain. So they go through some harsh trial, a trauma or a loss, big suffering, and they say, well, if this happens to me, it's probably because God doesn't exist. Or if he exists, he's on vacation or he's retired. And there's a beautiful work. This book is by Leon Denis called The Problem of the Being of Destiny and Pain by Leon Denis. We arrived at a conclusion that all you gotta do is look. There is no evolution without pain. There is no pain. Is intrinsic, is part of the growth process. To grow hurts. To evolve is to increase your resilience, your ability to endure certain sufferings. Had it not been this way, because not everything is cause and effect, because if the little bird broke its little legs, cause and effect, it bit his other bird in the last reincarnation, now he needs to come with a broken leg in this reincarnation, a little bird. So you can imagine that flock of zebra in Africa goes through the river. Let's see which zebra has bad karma. It comes the crocodile and bites the zebra. Oh, that one has the bad karma. And so we bring that assumption to our existence. So we go out there, sprain our ankle. Oh man, must be some debt that I have, or karma. Oh, I didn't rescue something. No. It's because you got to go to the doctor to have that, or pay more attention when you walk. Because there is the pain dash experience. So pain is implied, is present. Why is it that society's big problems today, in our contemporary society? This has been pointed out by great philosophers, religious leaders. Everything has become quick, fast food. The fast relationship, fast religion, everything is immediate, instant, and superficial. Everything is quick and superficial. So you enjoy it quickly, but for very little time, or very little. So that's the motto of the world today. And in fact, there is no love that is long-lasting that doesn't have pain. To relate with one another, it hurts. Love hurts. The poets say things in a way that are so much more simple. We spent hours, but one Brazilian poet, Amélia Prado, she says, love is the saddest thing. No, fala. Love is the saddest thing. Ah, and love is the thing that I want the most. That's it. So you arrive. Hey, hello, look, how are things with the new relationship? Oh, I'm not sleeping at all. I'm doing great. It's so good. Love it. But say that you're going to take them away. No, please. I'm just complaining, but I wasn't asking you to remove the person from my life. I'm just complaining. So the pain is intrinsic in part of this process. That's why the next item in this chapter, be perfect. I'm going to pause to go to this item and then come back later. It's item number... Number 10, the individual and the world. And the spirit that gives the message will say the following. When we say that we have to be a person of goodness, a moral person, we are not asking you to isolate yourself from the world, because that's the life of the selfish person. There is no merit in it, or very little merit in that. You need really to live together in society, in Madison Square Garden and on Friday night. They need to live in the world according to what the time calls for. But the message is incredible. It's item number 11 of the same chapter, which is called Caring for the Body and the Spirit. The message is from a spirit signed by the name of Protector Spirit, and he says something that's quite wonderful. That there are two systems. That confront each other. One is of the ascetics who want to bring down the body, and the materialists who want to bring down the soul. So he neglects the body, and the materialist neglects the soul in order to take care of the body. Those are two extremes. Where is the science of living? The wisdom in living? And the big problem would be without a solution if Spiritism had not come to assist those who study the issue by showing them the relationship between the body and the soul, and to tell them that since they are necessary for each other, both must be cared for. So love your soul, but care also for your body, the soul's instrument. Being heedless of the needs that are indicated by nature itself means to be heedless of the law of God. Do not punish your body for the wrongs that your free will has made it commit, and for which it is no more responsible than a badly ridden horse for any accident in my cause. Hence, will you be more perfect if you torture your body, but remain no less selfish and proud, nor more charitable toward your neighbor? No, perfection does not lie in this. It lies entirely in the reforms to which you submit your spirit. This is very interesting. When he's talking about the ascetics, to neglect the body, and materialism, which is to only focus on the body, look how he concludes this message. He says, these are two types of violences. Two forms of violence, each almost as foolish as the other. And alongside these two large groups swarm the countless multitudes of the indifferent, who, with neither conviction nor compassion, love with tepidness and are sparing with their joys. Look at what the Spirit is saying. He's saying, you know what? The vast majority of you is half in the middle about enjoying and having a good time. Is moderate. Because in the moment that you needed to enjoy fully, you don't. And in the moment that you need to be generous to love, then you are economical. You are lukewarm. Lukewarm. So this is a problem. Because we wouldn't like to identify the moral person as somebody who is, hey, how are you? Serving God, to the service of God. So it's something that doesn't have a lot of meaning. So when we observe this message, the first message is the individual and the world. And then he says, you need to live in the world. What's the clothes that you're wearing today? That's the fashion? Okay, wear it. There's no other way. You gotta live in the world. And don't be sparing in your love. May your love be abundant, ample. If it's to enjoy it, enjoy fully. So we start to observe. I went to the city of São Paulo and I met with the widow of Euripides Formiga, who was a great poet from Sao Paulo, and he also channeled a few books through the mediumship of Chico. He used to always visit Chico, and I said, is there any account or interesting anecdote? He said, yes, I have one for you. I arrived to meet Chico, we were talking, and then Chico called me to the kitchen. He was cooking. And then he turned to me and said, do you know how to make jello with the bone marrow of the cow? And he said, no, I don't know. So can you take a pen and paper? And the cook from the emperor of Brazil, the second emperor of Brazil, her spirit is here and she's dictating the recipe to me. Wow. What did you do, ma'am? Well, I wrote down the recipe. Did you do the recipe? We did the jello. Gelatin. Jelly. So give me the recipe. So she was the cook of the second emperor of Brazil. She's already deceased. So she was a cook. Imagine the scene. Yeah, hello, good morning. Good morning, Chico. Yeah, how are you? No, I was talking with the cook from the second emperor of Brazil. Do you know jelly with bone marrow? Want to eat it? So write down the recipe. And this would impress in Chico because people would seek him thinking that he was going to extract people from their environment, extrair, or kidnap them from their environment, or abduct, like ETs, like remove them from their world and take them somewhere in this higher spirituality where they don't eat or they don't drink and there's nothing. As if Givaldo once told me that he went to the bathroom to pee and he said, "Wow, Givaldo, you also pee?" Yes, I do. So when they would go look for Chico, when he would arrive, Chico would spiritualize their life, their environment. The daily living would fill itself with spirituality. So, while making the coffee and to serve the coffee, it was a spiritual experience to have it with him. So life gained a greater joy and happiness in the least details. In a handshake, in a hug, in taking coffee, in the eating together. It was amazing, and people would start crying while they were having coffee with Chico, and people wouldn't understand why they were crying. It was that simple. That was the daily life. And Chico was incredible. This calls a lot my attention because as I used to walk around the cities where Chico used to live, you talk to the people that live there and you people that used to work at the bank. He's there at the bank. Every week, Wednesday at 8 p.m. or 8 o'clock, Chico, or 8 a.m., Chico would enter the bank. He would arrive, he would call me by my name, say good morning, how is my wife, if all my children, he would call them by their names. That would fill us with so much peace. And he would always drink coffee. There's no translation. Like a little bar, like a nice underground bar. Like, think more, think deeper. There we call it a bodega. No, like a little small bar. A specialist to service bad liquor, like a bad pub that serves bad, cheap liquor. So it was there that Chico used to hang out to drink his coffee. My God, Bo, wasn't there a better place for you to go? He would go to the pub and people are drunk and falling all over the place and he's like, let me have some coffee. And an elderly lady, very proper, who was a very practicing spiritist, deeply. She went through the bar and she passed by the front of the bar and said, Chico, you in here? And he said, yes, daughter. when the Spiritist goes to a pub, it becomes a home. Or in other words, she thought that Chico was there innocently. He was there talking with everybody, helping everybody. So much so that one day he said, out of the blue, a completely drunk spirit showed up with terrible smell of liquor in his breath. The spirit appeared and said, Chico, yes, my son, look, I do a very important work for the good. He said, really, my son, what is your work? He said, the spirits disincarnate and they have difficulty leaving their bodies. I go there and I remove them from their bodies. And that smell, oh, my son, you're going to have a lot of work then when I die. Because and that spirit was his friend. So this is the sense, so that we can continue, so that we don't go back to promoting a system to think that purity, that goodness, that the moral person is the person who isolates themselves, the ascetic. It's not that. We can't this quickly identify a moral person by their appearance. Because the virtues therein are inside. So let's go. We had a little house in the interior inland state of my birth. There was a young man who was very, very, very intelligent, who graduated as a doctor in medicine. Very intelligent. A father who had a lot of wealth, who was a farmer, had a wife, two lovers, and a son. The son graduated in medicine in the capital city, in Rio. Medical school, thank you. The whole family died. The son, the two lovers, and the father. The father went to the lower regions of the spirit realm with the two lovers. The son took 8 years to leave the spirit world, the lower regions of the spirit realm, and he's Andre Luiz. And the mother went to the higher spheres in the spirit realm. So something's missing. So you're confusing the story. No. The mother? Where's the mother? She's there washing her clothes, doing the cooking the food, taking care of the kids, of the household. Went to a sphere that was much more superior than the spirit colony of Nosolar. She rescued her son. She signed her promissory note with the minister Clarencio. Here, I'll sign the IOU. Bring the boy. You see that he's good. For mothers, we are beautiful, intelligent, we're gifted. That's the love of mother. Love is blind. Thank God. It's blind and clairvoyant. It sees the future. So she brought the son to the spirit colony. The son recovered. But what's most impressive, so we can understand here, the moral person. So I went to visit dad in the lower regions. It's tough because the two ladies, they don't leave. They can't get away from those lower zones. It's a tough situation. I tried everything. Oh, my son, don't worry. We already have a solution in place. I'm going to reincarnate myself, and I'm going to receive your father as my husband. What about the two lovers? They will be born as my two daughters. So everything will work. So love is unpredictable. Because law of cause and effect does not have the power to do that. You don't take her from where she was. But for out of love, she goes. But look how this, it's so beautiful, the logic. Imagine these two daughters during their adolescent years, because this is what happens. The quantity of addictions that this man fomented in these two women, the habits that they cultivated, who's going to educate these two girls? Him. He's going to lose all his hair. And he's going to have to educate them, raise them. So what do we understand as something wrong is corrected through love or in love. Like a great river that receives stones and mud and dissolves itself in its current and dissolves the mud that is thrown into it. That's the moral person. What concerns me nowadays is to seek to be a moral person, but without losing the joy and the lightness of living, without losing the ability to be happy with little things. Let's have lunch with friends. Meet up. Take the son to the movies to eat some popcorn. Simple things that you can bring spirituality into it, because in those moments is when you build relationships. You don't build relationships when a crisis happens and you have to give your kid some advice. At that point, the relationship has to have already been built. In the popcorn, in the movies, that's when you build it. So, just so that we don't lose that, that's why the next item after faith in the moral person, so the person has to be able to do that. If he's not in communion, in connection with the Creator, he doesn't even have the energy to do that. Because there are days that you say, oh my God, oh, why did the day start today? So the next item, the next virtue is imbued with the feeling of charity and love for the next one, for the neighbor. Imbued with the feeling of charity and love for the neighbor, he does the good for goodness' sake without expecting any payment or retribution. He pays evil with good, he defends the weak against the strong, and he always sacrifices his own interest for the sake of justice. So it's good to realize the first virtue of the moral person has to do with trust in God and faith. The second has to do with relationship with our fellow men. Why isn't it the other way around? Because it's not possible. Without faith, goodness exhausts itself. It becomes anemic and faints. Without goodness, faith dries up, becomes arid, unbearable. So one complements the other. It's like wisdom and love, Emmanuel says. Wisdom without love is like a sign on the desert pointing to the direction. it points the way, but it doesn't quench the thirst. So the man in the journey dies. Love without wisdom is like a well in the desert. It quenches the thirst, but it doesn't point out to the path. So the pilgrim gets lost. So you need to unite the two. You need to unite the two, faith and goodness. Goodness is the tank filled. You go with the relationship with the other, willing to love, willing to tolerate, willing to forgive, willing to be indulgent, willing to support and bear. But there are times when the tank goes into empty, so you go there, fill it up from above, the trust, you fuel it up again and return back to the relationships. Otherwise, you don't get the energy. Your goodness doesn't maintain itself. So then he continues on to say, now all of the virtues are children of charity. All of the virtues of the moral persons are children of charity. While the service in making others happy, in drying up the tears of others, in consoling and comforting others, to the afflicted ones. That's the first impulse, is to think of others before thinking of themselves, to take care of others' interest after your interests. The moral person is good, humane, benevolent with all, without distinctions of race, creeds, because in all men he sees as his brothers and sisters. He respects the convictions of everyone. In every circumstance, he takes charity as the helm. Doesn't feed hatred, rancor, or the wishes of revenge. Is indulgent. Does not find pleasures in looking out for defects in others. It's a list that we can summarize by saying charity. The question in the Spirit's book, the true charity, benevolence with the others, indulgence with their imperfections, and forgiveness of offenses. That's the tripod that sustains true charity. So what Kardec has done in many paragraphs was to elaborate on this true charity. So the moral person, first virtue, faith, is charitable. And secondly, charity in the highest extent, to think of others, to receive others, to comfort others, respect others. Respect, not tolerate only. Because to tolerate it almost becomes like a condominium, a building. You don't like the person, but it lives underneath you or above you. You tolerate. Here's respect. To respect is to value, to understand the differences. To do in such a way that the differences are understood and respected. And surprisingly, Kardec begins to list virtues of the person who is moral person, in a very interesting way. Look at what he says. They study their own imperfections. Study. And strive incessantly to combat them. All their efforts are focused on being able to say to themselves tomorrow that they are better than they were yesterday. There's an exercise here that was practiced by the Jesuits, an order of the Catholic Church. It's an order that came about as a result of a militaristic practice. Its origins lie in the Roman armies. They're very disciplined. And there's a technique that they do, which is a very interesting technique. But be careful to adopt it. You need to know who you do it with. At the end of the year, there are 10 people. You make a group of 10 people. And each person of the 9 in the group, besides you, they're going to do a list of all the defects or imperfections that they see in you. But they're not going to identify the person without identifying. They're just going to list. Haroldo, example. I think his imperfections are this. Make a list. In another piece of paper, list the qualities, the virtues. And you're going to do the same. So you do 2 lists for each of the 9 members, and all 9 do for you. So you receive the 9 pairs of lists. And you separate the qualities and the defects, the imperfections. And so you go, no, I can't be that. No. Even though it appears on all 9 lists, I like to protest. I object. Or it's a curious thing. Only one person noted this quality of mine. Just one person. So it's an exercise. It's very interesting. Because we have this kind of myopia to see our own imperfections. And the title of the chapter is Be Perfect. How are you going to seek perfection if you don't study your imperfections? Now understand, to study imperfections is not to name them. Oh, I am proud. And I also almost say that with pride. I am very proud. To study imperfections is to start to ask yourself, what do I gain from being prideful? Because there is a gain there. In which circumstances do I express in a more intense way my pride? In which situations do I hide that I am prideful? That's studying the imperfections. That's study it. You go to the causes. The causes of the imperfections. All imperfection brings some kind of joy. Otherwise, you would get rid of it already. Some pleasure you get out of it. You have some gain out of it. You may say, oh, I have some imperfection. I'm so aggressive. I impose myself too much. I say, oh, thank God. As if you say, thank God. So what gain you have with this? When I say nobody argues about it, everybody obeys me. Obeys you?
When you study your imperfection, you see that the people pretend to obey you, but behind your back they boycott you, because people only do what they want to do. So this is not a game for amateurs. You don't play with imperfection. Imperfection must be studied like a 007 agent. You have to design a strategy. Yeah, design a strategy. I like Chico because there's a case that he said, temptation is like you go out running away from a dog wishing he can bite you. There's a pleasure in the imperfection. You feel joy in that. Because it's hard to get rid of it.
And
imperfection must be studied. I'm trying to understand that. And you study, and it takes time. In the roots, in the hidden roots, when you finally identify this hidden energy that is nourishing your imperfection, then it solved the problem. But it's not an identification here in your brain. You say, aha, that's it. This is it. This is it. Now you have the condition to transpose. Another very important point. You don't get out of the imperfection without put another foot in a virtue that is opposed to it. Nobody leaves a house before built the next one. That's why the challenge for the moral perfection is to create small habits. If you are capable of to forgive three times a year, per year, yeah, depending on the offense. So good, so invest on that. Otherwise, you're not going to go ahead. The phenomenon of leave a vice towards a virtue is a phenomenon of exchange. You leave here and go there. You don't leave before you know where you're going to, because the energy that is in the vice will be utilized by the virtue. The energy is neutral in itself. You want to see that? Egotism and pride are love. It's an immense love. By yourself only. But it's love. And it's a very important self-love. You need that. You need it. And here's the big question, that's the imperfection must be studied. What I'm saying here is in the Spiritist book, when Kardec talks about the vices. The vices are like a horse, they must be educated. The energy itself is good. The problem is direction and intensity. So, imagine that individual who has four paws. He is unbearable with his sincerity.
His
sincerity is a samurai sword. Before it's dripping blood, he doesn't stop. Do you know anyone like this? What is the problem here? The problem is, first, intensity. So he needs to lower the volume. Minus, lower, even lower. Second, he needs to change direction. To separate a little bit of this energy of seeing others' defects and see his own defects. If he can control the direction and the intensity, the vice will transform into virtue and he will become a sincere person. So imagine a person extremely sensitive. It's so sensitive that in electoral propaganda music, he cries. So he needs to diminish, to reduce the intensity, lower the intensity, give direction to that energy, and he will be a person capable of accomplishing something. With this necessity, he will not accomplish anything. He's so susceptible, he gets offended by anything and gives up because, you know, with Peggy, and I'm not going there anymore because someday in September 11, when I was walking down that street and somebody, that person didn't look at me, so I'm not going back there anymore, things like that. So it needs to adjust. Look at our vices, not like something that needs to be exterminated, but something that needs to be modulated, adjusted, molded. Change the direction and intensity, it will turn into a virtue. It will become a virtue. Let's not get fooled ourselves. The energy, that transformed the pride was in Chico. Otherwise, he wouldn't work 85 years getting all the stone. Who has a personality like that to stand like that? Long like that.
But
the energy was in the intensity and direction that is supposed to be. When she received the work, Evolution in Two Worlds, a team of doctors were there. And they said to Chico, Chico, we are all here doctors. We like you. We even like you. When after read the work, we all came up to conclusion. This work is wrong, is mistaken, full of mistakes. And Chico said, is it? Look, this spirit, André Luiz, this discarnate spirit, is here. I'm going to ask him. You want to ask some questions? I'm going to ask him. So they will direct questions to the spirit, discarnate spirit, André Luiz. André Luiz is saying that he's right and all of you are wrong.
Então,
Time has attested it. Time has proven it. The energy was there, but in the correct intensity and correct direction. And it's funny that 2 weeks ago somebody told me a personal matter. You know, this very humble person, very simple person, went to visit Chico, and he was going through a problem, and he wanted to talk to Chico, but there were 2,000 people in front of him. So after 5 hours in the line, he was impatient already. He was looking at Chico and saying, everybody was looking like a frog. He looked at Chico, Chico smelling like a frog, too. Just like that, he was thinking this. He was not speaking. And somebody came and gave some ointment, giving away ointment that they do. 2 more hours later, it was now his turn. He said, hi Chico, how are you doing? How are you doing? I'm smelling frog, son. And then he rushed. And he said, oh Chico, yes, thank you, goodbye. His Chico said, no, hold on. I'm going to give you half of this ointment. This is good because we understand that. What is the point here? If you study your own imperfections, if you really understand your limitations, it gets easier to get others' limitations. It's natural. It's just natural. I'm just like this. I did this. I'm just like this and this and that. I can do this. I cannot do this. I cannot try. I cannot expose myself to certain situations because I'm weak on that. I cannot do this. I cannot do that. When you identify yourself, you create automatically one. Indulgence. Yeah, that's why Joana says that love that you have for yourself, not in love in the sense of pride and vanity, is the genuine, the pure love. That love that you have for yourself modulates the love that you have for the other. Because the problem is not you think that you don't have any defect problem. The problem is, if you think that you don't have imperfection, you don't tolerate others' imperfection as well. Because somebody come late to you and say, good morning, you said, no, you are 30 seconds late. When you study your imperfections, when you live with your imperfections, when you get aware of the challenge that carry a vice, how is hard to overcome a vice? It's too hard. You look at the other and you understand. I understand his struggle. It's not easy. You start to see beyond. Kardec goes on. The good world does outstand his spirit and his own talents in detriment of others. You value yourself, but not in detriment of others. I'd like to put one point here. And this is part of an education process, a millennial of our civilization. In our head, in our brain, it's almost impossible to separate the like from the dislike. If you go to an ice cream store, which one you like? I like the strawberry. I don't like pineapple. Why do you like what you like? You have to like that what you don't like. I like ice cream, chocolate ice cream, and period. And what about the strawberry? Yes, yeah, as well. Same thing. Vanilla? Yes. Folks. Do you get it? So we have a habit of to exclude. I like the blue. So we imagine the whole world blue. Would you like it? Blue grass, wall, blue walls, blue ceiling, yourself blue, blue skies. In God, there is the embracement of all things, even for the imperfect ones, because He is the continuous action of perfecting what is imperfect. So let's stop it. No, I like this and not that. So leave it. Do you like this? Somebody else likes the other one. So this is a point which is good for the psychism, for the moral person, because he knows his own value, but doesn't compare himself in detriment of the other. So I'll do this better than anyone, but why comparing this? What is the necessity to compare? So a moral person, like is here, he knows his value, but not in detriment of the other one. The other one is different and has its own value. Even if you are not capable to see it, some people are not capable of seeing. I know my neighbor has some value, but I still can't see it. But he has it. Has it. You know why? The universe belongs to God. What doesn't have value does not exist. It only exists what is valuable. For the simple fact of that exists some dignity that I cannot see, but the creator sees. This is the scenario. I'm going to give you a practical example from the book Paul and Stephen. Stephen? Stephen was intelligent and good and spiritualized. So why didn't Jesus choose him to preach the gospel. You were talking so good about Stephen, so let him preach. So when Stephen is there in the book, and he said, Jesus looking at Saul, Stephen is in agony. It's like a Hollywood movie scene, because Stephen was stoned, he is in agony, almost dying, and Jesus come from the spiritual world and start caressing his hair, like rubbing his head with caress, and looking at Saul with a sad countenance. If it was me, I would be whining. I'm dying. Can't you see that I'm dying? I'm dying. I'm suffering. I was stoned. No. When Stephen realized that Jesus was looking at Saul, then he started working as advocate. So he looked at Jesus and says, and he feels the energy, but if this, the energy that he defends Moses would defend him, I wouldn't be able to compare, because Jesus knows his fervor in defending Saul. And Stephen's incarnate, Jesus takes him away and leave the time and pain, and later he comes to Paul, to Saul, and said, no, you are my chosen vessel. And Jesus said to Stephen, and so you go to Saul, the one who was persecuting me? Saul is such a common name. Is there any other Saul? The one who was persecuting me, or is there any other Saul?
No.
It's not the one who was persecuting me to kill me. And Jesus said, yes, that's the one, my chosen vase. And says, oh God. I'm done. So go to Ananias. Why? There was no value. Saul had no value. But for Christ, he was the chosen vase. The chosen vassal, the moral person knows about his own value, but he doesn't need to compare himself to others. He doesn't need to diminish to them the other one to shine himself. He doesn't need. And this itself is one virtue. Because many people spend more energy in dimming the other one than growing himself. In order to feel great, he has to make everybody midgets. It's a sick process. It's not pride of his riches, use but doesn't abuse from what was confused. If he treats all the subordinate with benevolence, that is to say, the moral person, it's not necessarily somebody in need of material goods. Which is another confusion that we normally do. We commonly do. Because here, Kardec spends three paragraphs to talk about a good person with material possessions. But he uses but doesn't abuse. He helps the neighbor with this rich. He treats the subordinate with love, tolerance. It's all here. So we need to fulfill another paradigm, shatter another paradigm. The paradigm is the moral person is one. It only prays, and nothing else. It's an erroneous vision, and the other vision is the good man is dead only, has nothing. No, this is not it. The good person could be someone invested with a lot of resources. To break this paradigm. It's appearances only. And finally, he respects all of his neighbors. Finally, moral persons respect and their fellow beings all the rights arising from the laws of nature in the same way they wish their own to be respected. This is not a list of all qualities that define moral persons. It's on the path. And this is very relevant because Kardec ends the message saying the good man is one who is in the path. It's not somebody that has arrived. It's not somebody ready. It's on the way. Because he has as his aim absolute perfection, God. So he's permanently on the way. And why was Jesus the model of the good man? Because besides possessing all these virtues, he's still in the way towards perfection. When the man says, good master, he says, why are you calling me good? Good is God. Good is God. And he gives an example. The most sensational example of all, which is, thy will be done. Because he, as a governor of the planet, could come here and say, I am the governor of this planet. Who directs this planet? It's me. And is that how Jesus does? No. In the most important moment of rejection, of not being received of his government, his action, he says, thy will be done, because you are the one who governs. With this, I hope have to take you into a helicopter ride over Manhattan, over these texts, in the hope that these virtues be awakened in us. And the challenges set to all of us, none of us here is in better condition than the other. We have all the same resources. What will distinguish us will be our effort, our dedication, and the time spent in the study of our imperfections and the development of these virtues. And I'd like to say, and maybe this is even more important, the purpose of the Spiritist doctrine is this transformation in me. In me. If this purpose is reached, the Spiritism will have fulfilled his role, at least in me, in you, to make us better persons. And here, I'd like to say also, you will not become another person.
You
will not be somebody else.
You
need to be better than you are. Because each one of us is unique. Me living your life would be a catastrophe. And you living my life would be a tragedy. That means you are the best person that exists to live your life. You were endowed with the best conditions that your life demands. There's no one else to occupy your place, to live your life. That's why this is a wonderful project. I only need to be better than myself. I only need to perfect myself. It may look like another person. At the end, I have changed something. I will look like somebody else, but this is what we have best. It's hidden. It's just a matter of flourish. I wish you all a good walk in your path, a good journey to all of you. And may the Spiritism be able to console and clarify you enough to make you remain in your march, because this is not a 100-meter
dash.
This is a marathon. The winner is the one who finishes. That means don't give up. If you fall, get up. It's not a speed trial. Has more to do with consistency, with perseverance. Sometimes a little bit stubborn. Thank you. You all good afternoon.